Instead, her body shot off into heaven when her life came to a natural end. Of course, there's no evidence for this. Even the Bible says nothing about how Mary died. The belief that her body was lifted into heaven emerged about 6 centuries after Jesus' time, made up, like any tale, and spread by word of mouth. But it became established tradition.
It was handed down over centuries. And the odd thing about tradition is that the longer it's been going, the more people seem to take it seriously. It's as though sheer passage of time makes something that was, to begin with, just made up, turns it into what people believe as a fact.
By 1950, the tradition was so strongly established that it became official truth. It became authority. The Vatican decreed that Roman Catholics must now believe in the doctrine of the Assumption of the Virgin. Now, if you had asked Pope Pius XII how he knew it was truth, he would have said you had to take his word for it because it had been revealed to him by God.
He shut himself away and thought about it. He just thought private thoughts inside his own head and convinced himself, no doubt on tortuous theological grounds, that it just had to be so.
None of this is particularly harmful when it is limited to the Virgin Mary going to heaven. But what about the Pope's personal convictions when it comes to, say, discouraging the use of condoms in AIDS-ridden Africa? Then the power of the Church through tradition, authority, and revelation comes with an appalling human cost.
It would be unfair to pick on the Catholics. All religions are up to the same tricks. It could be Muslim imams issuing fatwas. It's the same principle. It's issued by the authority and then passes down through the ranks to parents, to children, and all without a shred of evidence.
Unlike science, which sees it as a challenge, religion thrives on unsolved mystery. For early humanity, what was mysterious and unexplained was so vast that only an equally vast higher being, an alpha male in the sky, could fill that gap.
How would our ancestors have responded to the sunrise? There must be a fiery charioteer, a sun god to accept our sacrifices. A supreme being who, on the first day of creation, announced, "Let there be light."
But scientific investigation has rolled back that mystery. Today we know the sun is a giant nuclear reactor, one of billions of stars pumping out electromagnetic radiation, heat and light. How do scientists know the things that they know about the world and the universe? How do we know, for instance, that the Earth is 4.5 billion years old and that it orbits the sun that nourishes it?
How do we know that these dinosaurs are hundreds of millions of years old? The answer is evidence. Tons and tons of mutually supporting evidence.
Science is about testing, comparing and corroborating this mass of evidence and using it to update old theories of how things work.
I do remember one formative influence in my undergraduate life. There was an elderly professor in my department who had been passionately keen on a particular theory for, a number of years. And one day an American visiting researcher came and he completely and utterly disproved our old man's hypothesis. The old man strode to the front, shook his hand and said, "My dear fellow, I wish to thank you. I have been wrong these 15 years. And we all clapped our hands raw. That was the scientific goal of somebody who had a lot invested, a lifetime almost invested in the theory. And he was rejoicing that he had been shown wrong and that scientific truth had been advanced.
So So what does the overwhelming evidence of all these fossils tell skeptical science? How did we and every creature get here in all our improbable diversity? In past centuries, humanity had no choice but to resort to a supernatural hypothesis. Among the many creation myths around the world, the Book of Genesis imagined a designer God who fashioned the world and life in just 6 days. Finally, in the 19th century, science pieced together what had really happened. Charles Darwin hit upon a truly brilliant idea that elegantly explains all of life on Earth without any need to invoke the supernatural or the divine. Here's a helpful way to look at the problem Darwin faced. Climbing a mountain. Let's call it Mount Improbable. Let's say at the bottom we have the simple bacterial beginnings of life on Earth. At the top, man today, or any complicated piece of biology. So, how did we get to the top? If it had happened by blind chance, or by design, it would be equivalent to leaping up a sheer cliff in a single bound. Utterly out of the question.
If we come round the other side of Mount Improbable, we find something very different. Here there's no sudden precipitous cliff. Here there's a gentle slope, a gradient of evolution. All we have to do is put one foot in front of the other, and we'll get to the top.
Darwin's great insight was that life evolved steadily and slowly, inching its way gradually over 4 billion years. Natural selection, not a divine designer, was the sculptor of life.
So evolution, driven by Darwin's motor of natural selection, gets us to the top of Mount Improbable, from primeval simplicity to ultimate complexity. The design hypothesis couldn't even begin to do that, because it raises an even bigger problem than it solves. Who made the designer?
The abundance and variety of life on Earth may seem improbable, but it's self-evidently futile to invent an improbable God to explain that very improbability. I thought that in my lifetime evolution would be accepted and taught around the world as a scientific fact, supported by overwhelming evidence. But unfortunately, the whole point about faith is that even massive and constantly accumulating physical evidence cuts no ice. Evolution today is under threat. In the Bible Belt of Middle America, evangelical Christians are fighting back against science.
Our Father, our Father, who art in heaven, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
In the New World, religion is free enterprise. Rival groups set up shop on every street corner, competing to save people's souls and collect their money. Fundamentalist Christianity is on the rise among the electorate of the world's only superpower, right up to and including the president.